little in here. Everyone's gotten to move around. All right, so coming to our next presentation, I'd say Robert Doherty Bliss will be getting talking about a universe where the number two does not exist.
Hi everyone, thanks for coming out. Whether or not you're here because you're actually interested or you're bribed for extra credit somehow. definitely appreciate everyone being here. So let's go ahead and get started. This is a pretty bold claim, so let's talk a little bit more about what we mean when we say the number two does not exist. So, is everyone here familiar with numbers? You can just kind of nod. Like, right, you know, 1, 2, -4, things like that. I see a lot of nods. That's good. Okay. Now, we don't need all of the numbers for this talk. We're just going to need a specific set called the natural numbers. So they're written out here. They're the positive integers. 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. Now, I like to think that everyone is pretty familiar with the natural numbers. We see them a lot. You know, we count on our fingers all the time, things like that. So I've got some bad news about them, though. I think we have some misconceptions about the natural numbers. I think that all of us want to believe that the number right after 1 is 2. And that's great that you think that. It's it's really important to have opinions. Opinions are great. For now, you're wrong, but that's okay. It's good to be wrong. It builds character. So for the next 15 minutes, the natural numbers are going to look like this. So we're going to take the number 2, and we're going to toss that right out the door. All right, so everyone say it with me. The natural number right after 1, it goes 1, 3, 4, 5. There we go. Good. Nice to see that we're all on board. So, just in case there are some stragglers who don't believe us, there are two questions I get a lot when I bring this up. So the first question is, are we allowed to get rid of the number 2? And the next question is, even if we are, why do we want to do this? So first of all, sure, yeah, we can do it. It's fine. Math is nowhere near as rigid or as strict as people like to think it is. So we're going to make a small change, and we're just going to see what happens, like mathematicians have been doing for centuries. The next question I'm going to talk a little bit about later, because I think it's going to be beneficial to have some perspective on the question before we answer it. So we'll get to the why in a minute. So what we're going to talk about in the context of getting rid of the number 2 are the prime numbers. So I think everyone should be familiar with prime numbers, but if you're not, here's a quick definition. So a natural number greater than 1 is prime, provided that its only factors are itself and 1. So examples are 3, 5, and 7. Numbers that are not prime are called composite. Some examples are 4, 6, and 14. So the primes are pretty important in the context of the natural numbers. They're sometimes called the building blocks of the natural numbers, because the natural numbers are made out of primes. And we'll see a little bit more about that later on. But it's important to remember that the number 2, it was prime before we got rid of it. Be careful. So when we got rid of the number 2, did anything bad happen to the natural numbers? And I like to think of this as a game of Jenga, as I have there's a little note. You know, when you play Jenga, if everyone's familiar with that, you have a big tower. And we can think of the natural numbers as a big tower made out of blocks of prime numbers. So sometimes when you pull a block out of the tower, nothing happens. It's fine. The tower just stands there. But sometimes you pull that block out, and the tower comes crashing down, right? Scatters everywhere. So, which happened here when you got rid of the number 2? That's what we're going to talk about. So, the first number we're going to look at is the number 4. So typically, the number 4 is not prime. It is composite, because it has 2 as a factor. But its only factors are 4, 2, and 1. If we got rid of the number 2, what are the factors of 4 now?
4 and 1.
4 and 1. Glad to see you guys are answering. So 4 and 1 are the only factors of 4 now, so 4 is a prime number. And that's kind of surprising if you're familiar with prime numbers, because usually 2 was the only even prime number. So now we've got 4. So it's like we pulled this 2 block out of our Jenga tower, and someone slid in a 4 block right behind us. So maybe that was it. Maybe that filled the gap and we're done. Well, no, you'd be wrong about that too, but that's so. There are a lot of new prime numbers now. For example, if you go for 10, you've got 4, 6, 8, and 10 are all now prime numbers. And those are all even. So this is very surprising. Not only did someone slide in that 4 block right behind us, but someone dropped a couple new blocks on top of the tower. That's pretty interesting. So we want to look at exactly how many new blocks were dropped on the tower. That's what we're going to be visualizing. So we'd like to look at a little bit further than 10. I'd like to see when these new primes are falling down, how are they going to look? So to do that, we're going to use an animation. And ancients, an animation of something called the Sieve of Eratosthenes. So the Sieve of Eratosthenes is a way, if you have a big list of numbers, to figure out what numbers in that list are prime. So for example, you make a list from 1 to 100, like we're going to do, and you start off with the first prime number, which usually is 2. We'll pretend it's still there for now. And what you do is you mark off all the multiples of 2, because you know those numbers in your list are not prime, because they have 2 as a factor. Then you look at the first number that wasn't marked off, and you know that has to be prime, because nothing else divides it. So let's look at this animation here. We've got 2 animations. On the left-hand side, we've got the regular Sieve of Eratosthenes, where the number 2 exists. On the right-hand side, we've got a big black hole where 2 exists, because it doesn't. And so the red blocks are prime numbers, the blue blocks are not prime numbers, composite, and then the gray blocks are blocks that we're getting to. So as the left-hand side is going through 2, we already see there's a lot more gray on the right-hand side. So we're thinking, you know, there's more possibility for numbers to be prime now. We see there's more gaps, there could be more openings. And as we start to go through now, the left-hand side is working on 3, the right-hand side has moved its way over to 4, and we see there's still a lot more gray. And I'll let this run for a little bit as it speeds up. So already in the first line on the right-hand side, there's a lot more red. Oh, there we go, it's done. That's nice. So if we sort of look at the pattern here, the spread of the colors, on the right-hand side, we're seeing a lot more red. I mean, there's a lot more prime numbers from 1 to 100. The frequency of the primes is greater here so far. So it looks like when we were dropping those new blocks of prime numbers on top of our Jenga tower, we didn't just drop a couple. Looks like we dropped a pretty good number of them, right? Looks like there's definitely going to be significantly more primes. But still, 100 isn't very big in the context of natural numbers. You know, they go on forever, and 100 is only the first 100 of them. So what if we want to look a little further, say out to 1,000 or something like that? So tables, animations, that's going to get to be a little unwieldy out that far. So we're going to need something a little more high powered to look at it. This is not the presentation. This is the presentation. Yeah. So we're going to need something called the prime counting function. So the prime counting function is a famous function in mathematics. It's denoted as pi of x. Now, note, pi is not the number pi here. It's not 3.14, etc. It's just a Greek letter, that's it, it's no number. So pi of x is defined to be the number of prime numbers up to x. So you give it a number, and it counts the number of prime numbers up to that point. So, for example, pi of 10 is 4, because there are 4 prime numbers, usually, up to 10. So in the same way that we can define the regular prime counting function, we can define a new prime counting function, and we'll call it pi sub 2 of x. That is, we'll put a little 2 subscript there to remind us what we're counting. So this new prime counting function counts the number of primes up to a point after you get rid of the number 2. So pi sub 2 of 10 is 7 instead of 4, because when you get rid of 2, you get a couple new prime numbers up to that point. So if we can study how these functions grow in relation to each other, we can see what frequency the new primes occur, and if it's actually greater, and by how much it is greater than with the original prime numbers. And so with these functions now, we can look at something a little bit more high power than an animation. We can look at a graph. Oh, goodness. Let's see if we can look at a graph a little bit. There we go. That's it. Okay, so this is a graph of the prime counting functions, pi sub 2 and pi. I don't know if you can read the legend here, but the red line is a graph of pi sub 2 of x, and the blue line is a graph of pi of x. So the striking feature is that there's a giant gap at the end of the graph there, a big gap. So it looks like there's definitely more prime numbers when you get rid of the number 2, but the more subtle feature and more important is that gap wasn't always so big. So here at the beginning, there was no gap, and the gap grew a little bit, grew a little more, and it grew even bigger, and we see at the end we get that big gap. But that gap is going to keep growing. It's going to get bigger and bigger, and it can get as big as we would like it to get. So when we pulled that 2 block out, someone started to drop new prime number blocks on top, and they started to drop them really fast, and faster, and faster, and they're dropping them as quick as they can at a certain point. So our tower is probably, if we want to extend the metaphor, getting to be a little unstable now. We've dropped all these new prime number blocks on it. So it started to wobble back and forth, maybe, like in a game of Jenga. So is it going to fall down? So let's take a look at what's going to make it fall down. So I'd like to think that everyone here in the room has probably factored a number into primes before. So for example, you can factor 4 as 2 times 2 and 6 as 2 times 3. So there's a theorem called the unique prime factorization theorem, or sometimes the fundamental theorem of arithmetic, that says that for every natural number, you can factor it into a list of primes like this. And you can do it in exactly one way. There's only one way to factor any given number into a list of primes. So for example, 8 is 2 times 2 times 2, and it will never be anything else. It is only ever 2 3 times like that, or 2 times 2 times 2, rather. So this is very important, and that's why it's called the fundamental theorem of arithmetic. This is why the primes are considered the building blocks of the natural numbers, and this comes up a lot in applications. So I'll ruin the fun a little bit. This is going to be what makes the tower fall. And let's take a look at how it happens. So think about the number 64. The number 64 can be factored as 8 times 8, and also 4 times 4 times 4. If you don't believe me, you can pull out a calculator. It's fine. But if you do that, and you remember back a couple slides ago, the number 8, when you get rid of 2, is prime. And the number 4, when you get rid of 2, is prime. So you can factor 64 as a product of prime numbers in 2 different ways now. There goes the tower. The tower's going to all hit on your living room floor and everything. So there's really no picking it back up, putting it back together. So now that we've seen this, we can talk a little bit about why you got rid of the number 2 and what purposes we might have for that. So the boring answer for it is that it was fun. You know, it was a good little puzzle. It was something we saw in class, and we thought, oh, this might be fun to, you know, work on for a little bit. That's not a very good answer, though. I don't know. There are better answers. And it was a fun puzzle, but the better answer is that we use the prime numbers a lot. They are very important. Whether you think they are or not, they are. In mathematics, there are entire fields of study that just focus on prime numbers. There are fields that rely heavily on the prime numbers to prove things. And in the real world, things like cryptography, which is the study of how you keep things secret, keep things protected, things like internet security, computer security, a lot of that, believe it or not, is based on properties of the prime numbers. It's based on the fact that sometimes it's hard to know certain things about prime numbers. So if we're going to use these prime numbers so much and rely on them so heavily in our day-to-day lives, we should probably understand them pretty well. We should know intimately how they work. And I think part of knowing intimately how something works is being able to ask silly questions like, oh, we have this big list of prime numbers. What if we just threw one away? What if we just got rid of it? Would that change anything? That's kind of a silly question, but maybe we should be able to answer it. Because after all, we got rid of one prime number and everything came crashing down. It looks like the number 2 is very important for the prime numbers. So why is the number 2 important to the prime numbers? If we're going to rely on them, we should know why 2 is important. And was it because 2 was prime? Was it because 2 is first prime? Was it because 2 is the only even prime? Are other primes as important as the number 2? How about 3 or 5 or something like that? And I'm not going to tell you. That's the secret. But if we are going to rely on primes in our day-to-day life, we should be able to answer those questions. Is 3 important? Is 5 important? Are all of the primes important? Or is it just 2? So, like I said, I'm not going to tell you. I'll let you think about that. But I will be happy to answer any other questions you might have. You're willing to use the number 2 in your questions. That's totally fine if you want to do that. So
questions for our panelists.
About what numbers are, but a lot about how they work and what their relations are to each other.
So this feels like a stupid question.
This was a stupid question.
Touche. Well, so my first thought when you talked about getting rid of the number two, and maybe this kind of falls along the same line of the last question, but you end up with numbers like 10 where it seems like you can't say that 5 isn't one of 10's factors anymore, but you don't have like its pair to go along with it. So like, what do you do with that? Because I can't think of any other prime numbers that would like, well, one number goes into it, but we don't have another number to pair with it, so it's prime.
Okay, so I'll give you this one. 1/2 is a factor of 2. 2 times 1/2. Oh, sorry. 1/2 is a factor of 2, but 4 times 1/2. Is 2.
Right.
But we don't typically consider half to be a factor of 2.
That's what I thought.
Yeah, so it's something like that. It's like the number exists, kind of, in the same sense that 1/2 exists, but we're going to ignore it because we don't like it. It's not there anymore. Did that answer your question?
Yeah. Yes, it did.
Okay. Do you mean like in the real world, if you couldn't have like 2 hands or 2 feet?
No, so like you're saying that, well, prime numbers are important and whatnot.
Okay.
So if you were to take out an important prime number,
okay,
I guess based off our perception, like what would that indicate of another world that doesn't have a number 2, that never had a number 2?
So that's an interesting question, because I think that, you know, the mathematicians among us, and maybe the philosophers too, would like to think that mathematics holds in every world, so that in every world there will be this set of natural numbers, and the number 2 will exist. So what happens when you get rid of the number 2? That's interesting, because it looks like the primes wouldn't work anymore. If you were to believe that, okay, there is a number system where there's no number 2, it looks like we lost all of the prime numbers. And from a mathematical standpoint, that is going to make a lot of people really angry, because some people, their job is to study prime numbers, more or less. Some of them are called number theorists. So outside of that, though, like I said, if the primes are broken some way, where maybe you can factor numbers in more than one way, you're going to get a lot of issues with things, like I said, like internet security, computer security, cryptography, where maybe problems that we think are hard now in that new world are nowhere near as hard. They're actually quite easy or something like that. But they're not going to take anywhere near as much effort to solve as before. So I'm not sure offhandedly if there would be any remarkable differences. Like, we wouldn't wake up speaking a different language, I don't think, if the number 2 didn't exist. But there would be maybe some subtle differences, like maybe our cryptography would be based on something different that we didn't think to look at, because we do have the primes.
What was the approximate gap between pi of 1,000 and pi sub 2 of 1,000?
Ask me that. We can look at it. Let's see. All right, so that's at, someone want to eyeball this with me? Let's see. That looks like that's about 252, and that's 160.
About 160.
So what, say 90 prime numbers about, maybe? That sounds about right. And I never said the gap was going to go fast. I just said it would grow eventually. So it could take that for that gap to grow, say, if you want 1,000,000 primes between the two, it might be a long ways out before that happens. But it will happen eventually.
So you said the neutrons before the without prime numbers is pi sub 2 of 10. But 2 is included in that formula. So how does that tie?
Because there's a 2 in it, but it's not the number 2. Sort of. For example, you can still square numbers. Like, you can have 4 times 4 is 4 squared, which you notice I didn't write anywhere, so nobody would notice that. But really, I just have to cop out and say that don't pay too much attention to that, is my answer.
One last question. Yes?
Is there a defined function for the pi of x?
Oh, I'm so glad you asked. Yes.
What was the question?
Is there, what do you mean defined? Do you mean like, is that a real function?
I mean like, can you write out a function?
Oh, I'm less glad that you asked that. Okay, the question was, can you write out a formula essentially for pi of x? And the answer is, yeah, sort of. But not in a way that's going to make you satisfied, I don't think. The function pi of x is not something I made up. It's very famous. It's called Euler's totient function. Totient function. And it is the product, it is what people study a lot in number theory. It is heavily influencing the distribution of the primes. So I did not make this up. And there is a formula you can write down, but it's essentially like more or less count up all the primes up to this point anyway. So words doesn't
just well, again, I know many more questions about this. It's a very interesting universe, but let's give another thank you to our panelists.